welcome you all to the event tonight, where we're reflecting on the Chilean coup, and it's great to see such a full room. So my name is Jasmine Gidding, I'm from Birkbeck College, but I'm very happy to be here tonight to chair this event. And I'd like to just briefly introduce the three speakers. We're going to have do the three talks first of all, and then we'll just have one question for clarification after each paper, and save the discussion till the very end, because I think some themes will come out of all the papers, and we want to maximise our time here tonight. So our three speakers are Professor Alan Angell, who's an Emeritus Professor at St Anthony's College, Oxford, and his latest book is called Democracy After Pinochet. We also have Victor Figueroa, whose book I have here, so on Salvador Allende, and I'll pass around a copy for you to have a look at. And Victor teaches history at the LSE, as well as being busy writing books, so just pass that over. And I'm also very pleased to welcome Carlos Fortin, who is a research associate at the IDS, but he also spends half the year in Chile, where he teaches at the University of Chile in Santiago, and also at the think tank Chile 21. So I'm very delighted to welcome such an informed and knowledgeable panel here tonight, and I hope we're going to have a very interesting evening. So I will pass over to Alan first of all, who's going to talk about the international dimensions of the coup.
I think I'll stand up to the union. I've come from a long line of lost Methodist preachers, so it's nothing to do. There are three very good reasons for looking at the Chilean coup in the international context. One was that the coup received an amazing amount of attention from the international press, from political groups all over the world at the time of the coup. It's a marked contrast, saying the coups in Argentina were worldwide roughly at the same time, but you see initial condemnation, but then nothing much happened. The contrary was true of Chile. What was interesting too was the coup affected the political strategies of quite a number of European countries of the left of those countries. They thought that if it could happen in Chile, which is a long tradition of constitutional democracy, it could happen there. And it led to events such as the famous historic pact in Italy between the Communist Party, the Christian Democrats, and the alliance in Trot between the Communist Party and the Socialist Party. So it was a coup that many countries, many politicians, many people looked at to think, what's the lessons of the IND experience? What are the lessons of a coup? I think the third reason is important is that politics in Chile for 10 years was conducted not in Chile but abroad, basically. Things changed when the liberalisation protests began with the popular protests. And of course, there were movements inside Chile that don't exaggerate. But essentially, the locus of political activity of the Chileans, the Chilean left, the Chilean Christian Democrats who were in exile, was abroad in a whole large variety of countries. So, my first point is this is an extraordinary event that attracted extraordinary amounts of international attention. So why? Well, one reason is fairly obvious. What was happening in Chile was seen as an unprecedented attempt to combine socialism with democracy, to have a way of combining a path of radical social change without infringing the rule of law or democratic practices. And there was obviously an enormous interest in European countries, especially, could this happen? How would you do it? What were the obstacles? I think also it must be remembered the international context at the time was very favourable for an informed and committed reaction to the Chilean coup. The time of the student protest movements of 68, which happened everywhere, even in Britain. the time of protests of US involvement in Vietnam and other countries. The time when there were urban guerrilla movements in Italy and Germany. There was a strong reaction against the USSR after the invasion of Czechoslovakia in 68. So it seemed that the whole international context was very appropriate for contemplating what was happening in Chile. I think another reason for the coup arousing so much attention was, in some ways, it was the first televised coup. It was a coup that took place on television cameras, on photographers, throughout the world. And they were four or five absolutely emblematic photographs or incidents that took place that were mirrored all around the world. One, of course, was the Hunter Hawk of jets bombing La Moneda. So much of this caused an enormous reaction. Another one was these soldiers were burning books in the streets, which of course is very reminiscent of what happened in Nazi Germany. There's a very famous photograph of King Chilean wearing dark glasses sitting in front of all junta, which couldn't be more appropriate for your image of what a dictator should look like. There were prisoners. The photographs of the shots of the cameras of the prisoners in the National Stadium are waiting, God knows what's going to happen to them. Again, a terrifying image. And of course, finally, the image in 1976, 3 years later, when Orlando Letelier's car was blown up by agents of the DINA in Washington. So, I think it's also important to realize that for the Chilean government, a very important instrument of repression, not torture, execution, and so on, those of course were, but also exile. What the regime did was to practice exile on an extraordinary scale. Something like 200,000 Chileans were exiled throughout many countries of the world, mostly, of course, with some kind of degree of political connection. It's a kind of short-term measure of the junta to get rid of these dangerous people, but in fact it backfired very much, as I was trying to show. Because exile communities weren't passive, they organized and mobilized support for anti-Pinochet sentiment, both at the national level and in like the United Nations or the European Union. I mean, Chile was a country outside of Europe most debated in the European Parliament for about 15 years, usually, of course, but invariably to condemn it. So the trade union movement was largely funded from abroad. Academic institutes, such as the Institute for the Study of the New Chile in Amsterdam, others in Rome, were very active in producing a very widely read magazine, Chile America, giving support to exile groups, providing analysis of what was happening, providing condemnation. And they're very interesting, informative articles, not simply denunciation, but really close analysis of what was actually happening in Chile. There was also support for two radio stations in Chile, Cooperativa and the Radio Chilena. Cooperativa was, of course, very difficult to engage in any anti-junta activities. What Cooperativa tended to do was that when Pinochet made a stupid statement, which he made very many of them, including one in which he accused the German army of being composed of long-haired homosexuals and even worse trade unionists, what Cooperativa would do would be to say that there's an NPDC, and he would report this 20, 30, 40 times. So there was some way in which you could actually get it. But it very importantly, keeping alive inside Chile some sense that things were happening, that there was some opposition from various bodies. Extraordinarily important role in Chile was played by the Catholic Church through the Vicar de Guindilla Solidaridad, which is really an exceptional institution in the history of Catholicism, and nothing at all like it. Between 1975, when it was established, and 1979, something like 700,000 Chileans received legal assistance, health advice, nutritional support, occupational services. It was on a massive scale throughout Chile. And of course, this was largely financed from abroad. Catholic organizations in Europe and the US gave more than 67 million between 74 and 79. Another 20 million came from the World Council of Churches and other groups. This was the only center of any dissent in Chile, the only institution capable of making some sort of degree of statement about what's happening on the human rights front. Political parties, of course, were also dependent on foreign funding, though it's very murky, we don't know the sources, but clearly the Socialist International, the Christian Democratic International, were all active in funding the activities of the parties outside Chile. We don't know much about the whole thing, as it's very difficult to make any estimate. But know that from about the early 80s, about $55 million each year went to Chile. In Chile, after 1980, there were about 70 research institutes, most of course consisting, many of them consisting of publicly committed people. 95% of their budget came from abroad. Even the British government was not mostly interested in the fate of other countries, gave £11 million over a 10-year period to support Chilean academic students. The US, of course, was not really very interested in what was happening inside Chile, particularly being supported initially Pinochet, but there was a considerable degree of support from the US Congress, from American churches, and say from the Ford Foundation, which spent over $10 million in Chile during this period. Now, what was also striking, and this is important, is that the support for the Chilean opposition wasn't a kind of short-lived protest. It continued throughout the whole period, right up to the period of 1988. The whole period up to 1988, when plebiscite, there was an enormous support for Chile, which continued. Now, Lola. Sorry, I have a bit of a cold at the moment. So. Okay. One interesting question is, what effect did the coup have on the parties? Of course, the parties themselves indulged in a long process of self-analysis. What did we do wrong? What did the others do wrong? And so on. And it was quite clear that their thinking was influenced by where they were. Right? And the process of detaching the Socialist Party from a more radical Marxism, like swapping Lenin for Gramsci, began during this period in the Socialists who were located in Western European countries. If you're located in East Germany or the USSR, you tended to retain your sympathy for the public unities of Jacobins and Engels, less to indulge in divisionism. Exiles in Cuba, of course, received guerrilla training. So there was a general move towards accepting the importance of the market, the mixed economy, and of political compromise as a means of consolidating a stable democracy. Exiles in Cuba, Mexico, and Nicaragua were less convinced of this strategy and, in a sense, were fighting the battle still of 1970s. Obviously, the parties were very divided. There was enormous divisions inside the Socialist Party, in a kind of Euro-Socialist tendency and a more orthodox Marxist tendency. The Communist Party was much more united than one might expect, but there were divisions, because inside Chile, the Communists were more keen on taking violent action against Pinochet and for the Frente Patriótico, which of course was responsible for the almost successful assassination attempt of Pinochet in 1986. Christian Democrats suffered fewer alliances, so there was, fewer exiles, but there was enormous pressure from the German Christian Democrats, the Christian Democrat International, to move towards a more compromising position, to push them towards some kind of alliance with the moderate parties of the left. And of course, into all this you have the collapse of international communism with the fall of the Berlin Wall, which again led to a profound rethinking of strategies and tactics. Now, how did this international involvement affect the Chilean politics? Well, it's often customary to look at this almost entirely from the view of the effect on the left, but it had an effect on the right as well. And if the story of the coup and its aftermath is the story of the left and those who were persecuted, it's also the story of the right and those who were in power. Very few countries have been condemned so universally as the Chilean military dictatorship. Only three countries offered any degree of support: Israel, South Africa, and China. The votes in the United Nations were very, very powerfully against the Chilean coup. I think what that did, in a sense, was to increase the hardline tendency inside the military. Not that there were many softliners inside the military, but the possibility of some kind of an agreement, especially when the protests began in 1983, I think was effectively discounted by those who remained in power. But although they were rejected internationally, politically, they weren't rejected internationally, economically. So the other consequence of international involvement was continuing finance for the Pinochet regime from a whole variety of sources, the United States, various international financial agencies, and so on. So in a way, what you can see very clearly developing in this period, and continues today, is a very deep polarization between the two camps. There's a right which is popular. Pinochet had 43% of the vote in the plebiscite. And the opposition to Pinochet, of course, a much larger vote voted. But even so, the right remained extremely strong. And both were very committed in the centrality of their belief systems. And the left was obviously, and the Christian Democrats were in favor of democracy. The right felt that the Pinochet regime created an institutional structure which should and could continue, where even if Pinochet was defeated. So there really was, in a sense, two entrenched camps at this stage.
Just a
So I think when you look at the plebiscite of 1988, we've got seen for Pinochet, no against Pinochet, it was much more than a simple vote in favour of having the dictator stay for another 8 years. It was also, in a way, it symbolises two contrasting views of history. It posed a question about whether the coup was justified or not. And it's interesting how that debate still continues today. Even in the current presidential campaign, it features as one of the themes of debate, the fact that Ibn Mate voted yes in the plebiscite. I think it's impossible for a president to be elected who actually voted C in the plebiscite. But it's interesting how that still remains an important issue in Chilean politics, even at the present time. Of course, Piñera, the other party president, voted no in the plebiscite, which may have given him a little support enough to win that. Even although you can argue there's a great deal of convergence in Chile on economic and social matters, maybe too much convergence, the difference on the political difference on the coup, its aftermath, and of course the question of human rights remains still a very central part of Chilean politics. Now, there's a question, of course, is, well, how much influence did this have? How much did this determine what happened inside Chile? And the answer is, I think, it did to some extent, but it's not the whole story. The real basis of opposition for dictatorship must come from internal sources. And it came in the protest of 83, astonishing protest. I was there at the time, quite remarkable what was happening. They didn't come because they were influenced by abroad. That was democratic pressure coming from people who felt that the regime had failed in so many ways. Using human rights, economic policy was a disaster in the 82-83 period. And it really, in a sense, was the foundation stone for the eventual demise of the regime. Similarly, Chilean politicians came gradually together to make a compromise, and I think more important in the sense than external influences was the attitude of the church, which helped to create the first Acuerdo Nacional. But I think you can still argue that on the whole, international support for Chilean democracy was important, and it was positive. It's always a dangerous territory because you come into the question of conditionality. You know, what do we want in return for our support? Will you follow certain policies? I think it was less marked in Chile than many other countries because, in a sense, their ideals and aims were very similar. The other question is, well, did all this foreign influence distort what was happening in Chile? Did it distort things that would not have happened had the international support? Did it interfere in, like, with the internal, the natural development of politics in Chile? Yes, to some extent, I'm sure it did. We found this, for example, in the funding of opposing trade union groups, some more on the left, others much more in the centre of the market. And the funding of both of them created tensions in the trade union movement and helped to weaken it, so it still helps to explain why it's a very weak movement in Chile today. But I think not a great deal. In a sense, the proof is that the political map of Chile in 1989 remains very much the political map of Chile today in terms of voting for the major parties, in terms of agreement on many issues. So I think that the basic similarity, if you like, of objectives between the Chilean opposition and international forces combined to create an opposition powerful enough in the end to defeat the one of the strongest dictatorships in Latin America and to help to create a kind of viable democracy with many failings, and I'm sure Carlos would point out an extraordinarily important failing in Chile, but still one at least that has secured a degree of democratic stability and accord in the country. We saw a violent disruption of all that in the 70s.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to share some thoughts with you about an aspect of the impact of the military regime in Chile, which is now very central to the debates in the run-up to the next presidential election, which is the issue of inequality. One of the most perverse legacies of the dictatorship, of course. I have to sit down because I'm going to be manipulating the computer. So apologize for that. I was saying that one of the most perverse legacies of the dictatorship was an exacerbation of inequality in Chile in terms of income distribution, in terms of standards of living, and in terms, in fact, of the quality of life of different sections of the population. And that realization leads to what, for many, including myself, is a very striking paradox. Because Chile, in the 20 years following the restoration of democracy in 1990, Chile had 20 years of more or less steady and very respectable economic growth, and was governed by a coalition, the Concertación, of social democratic parties that were committed to redressing the inequities left by the military. Nevertheless, today Chile, despite the fact that in terms of poverty, it's been tremendous advance, and I'm going to show some figures on that, but as far as inequality is concerned, there's been no change. Chile is still one of the most unequal countries in the whole world. Figures of the UNDP, the Gini, in Gini coefficient, you see, for about 140 countries in 2010, show Denmark number one, the most equal, Namibia number 140, the most unequal, and Chile is in position number 122. So it's really pretty bad. Now, why is that? I'm going to try and explain that. On the one hand, with reference to ideological factors, and the fact that at some point contradictions within the ruling coalition led to the adoption of a neoliberal view of equality, embodied in the concept of equality of opportunity. And secondly, to some structural features of the Chilean economy that make for inequality, which the governments or the Concertación were not able or willing, perhaps, to address. And those have to do basically with the concentration of wealth, the concentration in the ownership of the productive assets, concentration of market power, and the heterogeneity of the structure, of the productive structure of the Chilean economy, which makes for inequality. And I conclude by suggesting some of the political implications of this in the current situation, and some of the policy issues that are being brought up by this debate. So let me start by showing you some figures that at least tell the story. This is from 87 to 2011, so that's the tail end of the dictatorship and the beginnings of the present government, which is the one that replaced the Concertación government. And the blue line is Chilean gross domestic product in trillions of constant pesos, and you can see that it goes up. About 5.5% is the average rate. There are ups and downs, but basically it's a very respectable by international standards. The red line is poverty, so-called relative poverty, not extreme poverty. So in Chile is defined more or less in terms of $4 per day. And that goes down from over 45% under Pinochet to less than 15% today. So significant progress. But the top one, the light green one, is the Gini index. And you can see that it's more or less stable. There is some improvement, right? From 57-something percent under Pinochet is 54% now. So there is some movement. But if you take that as the rate at which it will continue going, that it will take 143 years for Chile to reach the level of equality of Denmark. Right? It's not really a very serious political proposition to say that, right? So it's absolutely clear that Chile is a very unequal society. I have some more figures, but I'm not going to go into them because of the time. This is absolute poverty, which goes down even more sharply. And this is another measure of income distribution. But let's skip that. We can come back to that if you want in the question and answer period. This is more important because this has to do with the extent to which government policy have changes the income distribution after transfers and taxes. And the blue line on top is autonomous income, which is the primary distribution of income. Immediately afterwards, the income is received following production. And then the red one is the monetary income after transfers and taxes. You can see that in the dictatorship there was no difference. It's pretty much the same. There was no redistribution by the government. But beginning with the, in 1990, there is an effort to redistribute. But again, it's very modest. And it then trades finally in no more than about 2 percentage points of improvement again, if you use that particular Gini, the monetary income Gini, it would take 93 years for Chile to get to the level of 10. Now, why is that? My first answer has to do with the ideology. As I said before, with the fact that there were contradictions within the social democratic coalition as to how to tackle the issue of equality. Essentially, at the beginning of the process, the sectors, the more radical sector, particularly in the Socialist Party, put up the idea of trying to change the model, the neoliberal model. And that was, in effect, rejected on the grounds that the main task of the transition was to consolidate democracy, and that tampering with the model, which would give these rates of growth that we saw in the previous figure, would detract from it. But behind that, there was a more serious issue, ideologically, which is that important sectors of the Chilean leadership were quite penetrated by the neoliberal ideology, and particularly mediated by the social democratic parties of Europe, and in particular the Labour Party and the Third Wave, the New Labour and Third Wave, which adopted the neoliberal model and put sort of some kind of a varnish of social concern in that. And the result was the acceptance of this notion of equality of opportunity, which essentially means that the idea is not to try and reduce the difference between the various stages of the social pyramid, but make sure that people who are at the bottom stages can go on the basis of talent. So it's upper social mobility is the answer to inequality. It's not reducing the differences. And that combined, of course, with some kind of social network, safety network for the poorest. And that's what was shown in the first graph. As you can see poverty coming down, you can see that the level of inequality, the distance in terms of quality of life among different sectors did not change. And that was accepted just like that. And I have here a paragraph from one of the ideologues of the Concertación Socialista, Eugenio Tironi, which cannot be more clear. It says the Concertación model, quote, is based on the notion of opportunities created by the market. It is based on the expectation of social mobility of the population, which allows it to withstand high levels of inequality as the price to pay for the opportunities that are to come. The governing class told Chileans that the mechanism for this is education. It will open for them the doors to a future whose only limit is the talent of everyone. This was the tacit social contract, says Tironi, and the Chileans bought it. He was writing about the protest, the student protest. So the next things he said, I'm going to quote him, says that now the students feel swindled because they did their part of the deal. They accepted inequality, and now they're burdened with enormous debts and with the education doesn't give them any entry in life. So that was the first thing. The ideology was, in effect, borrowed from the neoliberal camp instead of the social democratic approach, which is, of course, equality of results, equality of outcomes, equality of position. But on top of that, there were some structural determinants. And that very quickly, this because I'm already being run out of time. Chile is a very concentrated society in terms of wealth, in terms of ownership of assets, and in terms of market control. Right? Four families in Chile own assets equivalent to 12.5% of the Chilean gross domestic product. Four families. And the United States, which is a very unequal society, certainly the most unequal in the OECD, 400 families own 10%. In Chile, it's four families that own 12%. And one of the four families is the family of the current president, Mr. Piñera. The five largest economic groups in Chile control 47.6% of the assets of all the companies quoted in the Chilean Stock Exchange. Half of the wealth of companies is owned by five economic groups. In terms of concentration of market power, there are two indicators there. I'm not going to in detail, but I'm just going to take the first one. See, if you want to talk about the other one, it's so-called Helfenden-Hirschman index, which is more refined. But the first one, the control of the market of sales by the three largest is quite a rough unready but good indicators. And you can see in the pharmaceutical sector, 93% of the sales are controlled by three companies. In the pension funds, which is the whole Social Security Chile, the Social Security Chile is private, basically. 74%, so it's three quarters of the market is controlled by three companies. In health insurance, which again covers most of the insurance, it's two-thirds, 64%. Mine, 61%, in forestry, 55%, in banks, 53%. Now, that makes for a very, very heavy sort of burden of inequality. Because this high concentration means that the income that comes from dividends, from interest, and from profits is concentrated in a few hands. So it's a structural determinant of inequality of income, the fact that wealth is concentrated and that economic power is concentrated. On top of that, there is this question of the heterogeneity of the productive structures, which essentially means that Chile is divided into two basic economies. One, highly productive, composed of large enterprises, highly capital intensive, concentrating essentially in the raw material sector, highly integrated with the global economy, and a very large sector of small and micro enterprises, which are very low productive indeed, and therefore whose income is much lower. And again, the figures are very, very telling, you see. If you take together micro enterprises and small enterprises, they are 96% of the total number of enterprises. They provide 64% of employment, but they only provide 10.50% of sales. By contrast, the large ones at the very bottom, with 1.40% of the total numbers, provide 22% of employment and 81.6% of sales. So these are the structural constraints. And all this, you see, the ideological debates and the structural determinants are leading at the moment to a resurfacing, a rediscovery of the issue of inequality in the political debate. And that's very present in the present situation. The candidate of the Concertación, who will definitely win, unless something cataclysmic happens, who was the president in the last government, has said that her main issue is inequality. It's back into the serious debate, right? As far as structural change is concerned, it's more difficult, you see. Because these features that I was just mentioning, the concentration sector, are a function of the model. And to change that, you have to change the model. And that's very difficult. A, in practice, Chile has become so integrated in the global economy that to extricate it is not an easy task. On top of which, there are sectors within the Concertación that don't want that. They are quite happy with being part of the global economy, a financial economy, and the raw materials economy. Commodities are doing very well these days, copper is doing very well. They don't want to touch them. So there is a problem there to tackle the very fundamental determinants of inequality, which means that even though from an ideological viewpoint there will be efforts at moving towards a more egalitarian direction, they will have limits. But there will be movement, and I will mention three elements which might be indicators of change. Right? The first one is taxation. Chile has a very regressive tax system, based essentially on indirect taxes and very low rates of taxation to companies and profits. Now, Bachelet has said that she would change that. Not in a dramatic way, but substantially in order to try and make the tax system a bit more progressive. By the way, that's the reason why the Constitution could not transfer importantly income. Because if there were efforts, serious efforts that would distribute income, the taxation system was operating in the other direction. So the net result was very modest. The second is education, where again Chile is one of the most segregated educational systems in the world, according to the OECD. There is the private sector and the public sector, but the private sector has much higher quality education, much, much higher, but at the same time it's much more expensive. And within the public sector, which was municipalized by Pinochet, it devolved, a sort of populistic gesture, devolved the control of the schools to the municipalities, to the city councils. But the fact is that means that the rich municipalities have very good schools within the public sector, and the poor very bad schools. So it's highly segregated. Again, Bachelet said that she's going to try and do something about it. Exactly what is not clear, because again, these are things that don't happen overnight. These are the medium to long term type of goals. But there can be more. There will be movement, and the students are really sufficiently impatient today with what's happening for the last 3 years, that they will not allow minor things to happen. They will call for something important. The third one is labor, labor laws and the labor system, where again Pinochet set up a system specifically to prevent the workers from being able to regain part of the income that they lost during the coup, working for the government. And that is expressed in things like, for instance, the difficulties for unionization, like the prohibition of collective bargaining at the sector level, like the restriction for the right of strike, etc. Now, so far, Bachelet said nothing about this. And that's rather ominous. Because everybody knows that the business sectors, you see, the owners of industry, are more concerned with data than taxes. They're prepared to pay taxes. You remember the words, infamous words of Peter Anderson, when he said, a new labor is intensely relaxed about some people getting filthy rich as long as they pay taxes, right? Nobody says that in Chile, obviously, but it's been too far, right? But the business said, okay, tax is okay, but don't mess up with the labor. I'm quite happy the way it is. And the fact that there's been no announcement so far shows that there are problems inside. I'm pretty sure that there will be some announcement, and it will not be mine. But it probably will be short of what the Confederation of Labour is demanding, which is a complete overhaul of the labour code and a return to a situation which, by the way, is based on ILO conventions. I mean, there's nothing radical about this, except putting back Chile in the position it was before in there, right? So what I see for the future, you see, is certainly a move towards recognizing that these are very serious issues for the Chilean society. Right? That inequality has to be tackled as such. They're not good enough to promise upward social mobility. That's something else that we have. And some movement in the direction of changing the structural basis of inequality. But on both fronts, I see limitations, and I think they are a function of the fact that the democratic coalition, the Concertación, is a composite of different parties, of different ideologies, of different viewpoints, of different philosophies. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Very informative talk there. Quite disturbing, some of your data as well. I don't know if there's any questions of clarification at this point before we move on to the final speaker. So, any questions of clarification?
One question that occurs to me, Carlton. Is it possible to make any move towards greater equality unless you alter the constitution or the electoral system?
Yeah.
And those create such enormous impediments to even reforming the tax system unless you have a profound constitutional reform. And the Chilean electoral system is awful. It's one of the worst in the world, I think, probably. And that creates a veto power for the right. So any attempt to change labour law, taxation and so on, they veto. I'm sure you're right that the government has bought into them for the patterns and view of the world. But even sort of the structural obstacles, actually it does want to change the constitution, unless you can do that, I think you're stuck. Or is that too pessimistic?
Yeah. Well, I'm glad to raise that. I should have mentioned it a few times, obviously. It opens up a huge debate, obviously, and we just not have to go into it. But you're absolutely correct, you see. The constitution that the Pinochet bequeathed, as it were, is essentially devised and designed in order to prevent any substantial changes to the economic and the political model. And as you say, for instance, there are quorums to approve laws and setting the constitutional reform, which are totally unreachable. They're not realistic. So a new constitution is essential. Now, on that level, there is a debate. On the electoral system, there is in principle an agreement of all sectors, including the right, you see, to move away from the system, which in effect, with 33% of the popular vote, gives a veto to whoever is the minority on anything that in has any income. So it's really a tyranny of the minority in this case. But on that, in principle, this is the fact that there's already a project going on in that case.
Okay, it's a great honor for me to be here today and to share this panel with academics as distinguished as Carlos and Alan. It wasn't too long ago that I was actually a student at the Institute for the Study of the Americas. So I feel I've come a long way. What I thought I'd do today is throw out some ideas, maybe a few controversial points, and see if we can provoke some discussion around the issue of these things that we've been talking about today, the international ramifications of the coup, the economic legacy of the dictatorship, and also the legacy of Allende as the leader of the Popular Unity coalition, which was overthrown in the coup in 1973. Today, Chile is on the brink of an extremely important election. In recent years, Chile has been undergoing a process of deep social change and mobilization for the first time since the end of the dictatorship. Students, political parties, indigenous groups, environmental groups, social movements in the broad use of the term, have been pushing for changes to the institutionality that was left over from the dictatorship and reformed in the period afterwards, but the fundamental basis of which remain in place today. Old certainties about Chilean politics are fading away. So, for example, after recent reforms that made voting voluntary, there was 60% abstention in the 2012 municipal elections. And yet, in presidential primaries held earlier this year, the turnout was unexpectedly high. And 3 out of 4 voters indicated a preference for Michelle Bachelet, the leader of the new majority coalition. During the same primaries, support for the Christian Democrat Party, previously the largest political party in Chile, had fallen to below 9%, which is a historic change, arguably. And recent polls also show that support for the right wing, historically around a third of the Chilean electorate, has fallen to something in the region of 12%. And therefore, there's a real sense that there's a moment approaching at which real broad sweeping changes can be instituted in Chile. And this situation has brought about a series of debates on how to deal with the institutions and the political legacy that govern Chile today. And it's also led to the kind of, this debate takes place on the background, I would argue, of the Popular Unity government. Because since 1973, Chile has been governed by a neoliberal project in reality. And the only recent alternative to this in Chile is the Popular Unity. So that is kind of in the background of all these reform projects, and even in the coalition building of those that are seeking to change the system. It's also led to the use of political symbols from Chile's past, among them Salvador Allende, who was overthrown in 1973. And everyone on the left seems to be quite happy to be associated or identified with Allende's goals. But what I'm going to try and do today is ascertain what kind of Allendista content we might be able to find in the various kind of tactics that the left is adopting in Chile. And also what kind of Allendista methods are being used by the left today. Now, obviously, it's very difficult to make comparisons across historical periods where there are, you know, serious differences, but some loose parallels can be drawn, I think. And it will be interesting, I think, to draw them for those that have more knowledge about Chile prior to the coup, or more knowledge about Chile and the dictatorship, or those that are more interested in the social movements today. It's a way of combining these analyses. Now, Allende was a founding member of the Chilean Socialist Party. He was a lifelong politician. By the age of 29, he'd already been elected to parliament and was a minister of health in the Popular Front government in the 1930s. And for the next, by 1945, he'd been elected senator. And for the next 25 years, he was a politician in the Senate before being elected president. So Allende is a political insider. He's a man of the institutionality of Chile. And this was in a system which, by the late 1960s, many left-wingers in Chile are criticising as being illegitimate in many ways, undemocratic and leading to be thrown out of the window. This is a parallel that can be drawn with the situation today. Arguably, people like Michelle Bachelet and those on the left who are elected representatives are today facing similar attitudes that delegitimize them as being part of an illegitimate moral system. Today, as Carlos indicated, the Chilean opposition are arguing for reforms to the labor code, to education, to pensions, healthcare. Some sectors are arguing for more control of natural resources, taxation, and also more broadly for reforms that will democratize decision making in Chile and result in a fairer distribution of wealth, in other words, tackling this issue of inequality. Many of these issues are linked to the constitution, as Carlos just indicated. The classic example is education, but the labor code is also constitutional law. And so in order to change these things, you need to be able to change the constitution somehow. Now, these issues, democratic reform, economic reforms, and so on, are issues that Agende fought for to achieve his whole political life. So on one level, the popular unity government can be understood as a project to democratize the Chilean political system, or to lay the constitutional foundations, at least, for a more democratic political system. And at the same time, the popular unity was the last democratically elected government to seek structural reforms of Chile's place in the world, in the global economy, but also the way that was reflected in Chilean society, the way that wealth was redistributed. And as Carlos indicated, many of these inequalities and these structural problems remain in force today, as they did do during Agende's period. So what we can see is that although the period is different, the goals of the opposition on the left remain very similar to those goals that Agende and the Chilean left had prior to the dictatorship. And in fact, we can see that the method of achieving this change appears to be the Agendista method. In other words, whereas in the 1960s and 70s there was debate over whether participation in electoral politics was desirable or would function, whether it was revolutionary or not, today the whole of the left is engaged in electoral politics, and there are something like, I think it's 9 candidates for the presidency at the moment. Many of them are independent, standing further to the left on some issues than Bachelet. Now, in Agende's time, and as in the opposition to the current government, to the current system, is varied and to an extent divided on key issues. And I think it's useful to outline what these divisions are and draw parallels with the divisions that existed in the past. One of these issues is how to interact with the political centre. Those who don't want deep-rooted structural change in Chile, who think that the model can be adjusted somehow. And some left-wing sectors, particularly those that self-identify with the social movement in particular, reject the idea of alliances with those organizations which are or were members of the Concertación coalition which ruled Chile after 1990 until fairly recently. And this isn't just because the parties of the Concertación accepted the institutionality of the dictatorship and its socio-economic system, it's also because they helped to entrench that institutionality and entrench that socio-economic system over a long period. And many people to the left argue that individuals within this concertación enriched themselves during the process. For others, Bachelet's perceived betrayal of the student movement in 2006 and her sanctioning of the use of Pinochet-era anti-terrorism legislation against the Mapuche indigenous peoples in the south of Chile have also tainted the left of the Concertación, so Bachelet herself, but also the Socialist Party in general. And so for these groups that are outside of the Nueva Mayoría today, it is immoral and illegitimate to work alongside those who have betrayed, as it were, the popular movement in the past. Those groups that are, on the other hand, in this Nueva Mayoría Bachelet coalition, the new majority, think that the method to achieve change is to make broad alliances with all of those who recognise the need for reform to the current system. And this coalition today consists of the Socialist Party, the Communist Party, the Christian Democrats, as well as a series of other centrist and left-wing groups and political parties. The differences between these two broad perspectives echo past disagreements that Angell would have witnessed over whether the alliance of the left should be a multi-class alliance. In other words, whether it should include elements of the, to bring back a phrase from the 60s, the petty bourgeoisie, the middle classes, or whether it should be a very narrow and pure working class coalition. And historically, this division has existed within the Chilean left. So in the 60s and 70s, you had the Allendista sector of the Socialist Party, the Communist Party, and so on, who thought that this alliance with the centre was a prerequisite for achieving structural change. And you had another sector that I would argue could be called the rupturist sector of the Socialist Party groups within the popular unity and outside it, who argued that the system needed to be broken if it was and destroyed if it was to be transcended. So as in the past, today the left remains somewhat divided on this issue. The left is also divided over its appreciation, I think, of the political moment in Chile. So for some, the political moment, the collapse of the right, the increase in social mobilization over the last few years, marks a need to push forward with further social mobilization and in order to break with the institutions of the past and also to break with the concertación. Now they want to make a clean start and establish new institutions. So as Marcel Claude, one of the independent candidates, has said, we want to capture Rome because that's where the power is, and we want to burn it down. I don't want to be named emperor. I want to destroy the city. I don't want it to be where the political power lies until the end of time. I would take that power and build a new city. Now, this sector also have what could be called a kind of voluntarist, in the old language again, interpretation of politics, where the will to achieve a goal can impose itself over the difficulties of achieving, over the obstacles. And because of this interpretation, they tend to play down institutional problems and exalt social movements as a whole and the grassroots. And this can be seen in various candidacies, like that of Rosana Miranda, for example. But again, quoting Claude, he said, I don't work for a project that represents social movements. I've been part of those social movements for 20 years. So there's this idea that those that engage with the concertación and with the centre are somehow betraying the social movement that has arguably created this particular political moment. Now, for Allende and those of his generation, this division between... there is a problem with this approach, I think, and that is that it leaves a question mark over what to do if these groups do win presidential power, but don't dominate parliament. That makes it impossible to achieve constitutional change within the existing framework. So although they're participating in the institutional process of elections, where is their end goal? I think that's one of the key problems for this sector of the left. Now, for Allende and for others of his generation, the division between social and political wasn't as clear-cut as it appears today. Thank you. And I think at this point it's probably useful to summarise some of the basic characteristics of Allende's politics and see where, so we can see where they lie in the situation today. Now, Allende believed in the strategic alliance between the Socialist Party, which is a very heterogeneous organisation, and the Communist Party. He argued that this would ensure the revolutionary nature of the coalition and of the Chilean left's process. Allende also believed in the pluralism of the left itself. So he was anti-dogmatic within the left, and he consistently tried to incorporate groups which had rupturist critiques of his own path towards power, for example. Believed that this dialogue, as long as they could agree on short-term goals, this dialogue would enable them to overcome obstacles on the way. Agenda also believed in the need to build cross-class alliances in order to institute change. And we can see this in the way that Agenda tries to get the precursors of the Christian Democrat movement to join his coalition in the late 1950s. This doesn't work, but throughout his political life, one of the main themes of Agenda's work is trying to reach out to the centre and bring it in to the coalition of the left. Agenda also is a great believer in democratising the practice of the left, so integrating what social movements did exist at the time, women's organisations, trade unions and so on, into the policy-making process of the left as a whole. So in that sense, he does have a vision quite similar to the Labour movement in Britain, where it's like a federated vision incorporating a political party which feeds off the vision of the social movements. Now, elements of all of these approaches can be seen in the new majority coalition and in the way in which it is presenting itself in the policies that it's putting forward. But there is also a final factor that's present in the left as a whole, those that are seeking changes through institutional means, and those that are arguing for a kind of rupture with the past and with the concertación. And that is that Agenda's vision of the role that social forces, as he calls them, play in changing institutions of state. So, for example, he thought that if you could capture political power at the same time as social mobilizations put pressure on the political system from outside, then you would be able to transform it from within and from without. Okay, and it seems to me that broad sectors of the opposition today, in their willingness to engage with the political, with the electoral process, but in their lack of definition over what they will do if they do not achieve the parliamentary majority of at least 2/3, which is what they will need in order to institute constitutional reforms, is an indicator of the fact that they now believe that social force and social mobilisation will play a role in helping them to achieve changes beyond the period of the elections. And I think that this shows that Agenda and his legacy is present within the Chilean left today, but also will remain so while the Chilean opposition uses institutional mechanisms to achieve change. Thank you.
Someone at the back, perhaps you'd like to kick off.
I have two questions. One is, given the history of the right in Chile, do you see any possibility, I mean this is a general question for you three, of a democratic right? I mean, given, for example, that the current debate is dominated also by the dictatorship and by the past, do you see any possibilities of a democratic right for the future? And the second one is, Chileans see themselves as isolated from the rest of Latin America. So my question is, and maybe one of the very big fears of every political coalition is populism. Do you see for the future, if Bachelet doesn't like articulate this social mobilization or these social forces, do you see any risk of populism for the future?
Are there any other questions before we have a response to that? Yes.
This question for Dick, which is to do with the legacy of Allende and being reflected today. I'm wondering what the lessons are that are being drawn from Allende. Can you talk about the influence, but obviously the Unidad Popular government didn't succeed. I know them but because of the coup, but also because of the problems within the UP. So I think you put forward a really positive and promising kind of idea there. And I don't want to rupture that, but I want to suggest. I mean, but I want to ask, you know, what are the lessons that are also being learned about what went wrong in terms of how to approach the future and integrate all these movements that you're talking about?
There are any other questions around that? Yeah. Oh, okay.
the constitution, actually. I'm really interested in hearing more about that, because Chilean, we think that without changing the constitution, there is nothing we can aspire to. So the main aim is to change the constitution. How feasible is that? Because everything is in the constitution. So if we are able to change the constitution, then our life will be much easier, as we want to believe. So I would like to hear the views about how easy it would be.
Connected to that, really. Sorry, as a rejoinder to that, is that how much of an excuse has the constitution actually been used? Because I think the Constitution has, in a way, said we can't do it. You know, the Constitution is holding us hostage, and actually, it's questionably used as a great get out that we can continue with the neoliberal project.
Okay, so if we perhaps go in the order of speaking.
On the question of is there a democratic right in Chile, well, that's complicated. There are democratic politicians on the right in Chile, people like Angell and some others in Reconsiders Nacional, not in the UNI. I think this is a major change. The UNI is the single largest party in Chile. It's extraordinarily well organized, it's extraordinarily ideological, it's extraordinarily right-wing, and basically it's an expression in the sense of Opus Dei, the views of Christ, no sort of sensitive movements. And I think, you know, they still, in a sense, if you read an interview with Joaquin Novoa the other day in Mercurio, they still refuse to budge, in a sense, from any responsibility for the coup. So until UDI changes, I think that's really very unlikely. Alemán might have been presidential candidate, he wasn't, he was defeated, and they now have Alemán as presidential candidate. But it really is, I know no other right-wing party like this in the world, practically, with any sustainability or strength. Someone asked a question about Chile, not in America. I think UDI is the only party like this. The right normally operates through business groups, through pressure, through the media and so on. Chile, the right does that as well. But essentially, the real power core lies with the UDI. And it's very difficult to see the UDI actually becoming democratic, and in a sense, offend all the kind of principles that the UDI stands for. On the question of the constitution, how feasible? What a question. I'm not sure. I'm rather pessimistic, in fact. I mean, there were changes in the constitution in 2005-06 by Lagos, and Lagos is now our constitution, rather than the leadership was struggling to be rather too optimistic and so on. It's very difficult because, you see, in Congress you need a certain really large majority, a super majority. You need 5-8 to pass these sorts of laws, and getting that through the existing constitution, the existing elected system, really is extremely difficult. I suppose things do change over time, maybe, you know, I don't see it happening in the near future. How far the constitution uses an excuse? Well, it's a very good excuse, because it is very difficult to alter things, but I'm sure you're right in some ways that it is actually used as an excuse for not facing them, for not really, in a sense, presenting the dilemmas to the country more clearly as to why we can't achieve these objectives. I mean, you mentioned the social policies in Chile, in a way, are funded basically by profits from copper, a state-owned copper company. They don't come from the flat and taxation and so on. So that when you have a good reason for not, a good let-out in a sense, you always fund social problems. I mean, actually, its popularity was very low halfway through the term. It recovered when they started using the profits for very imaginative social programs. But that's not a way to run an economy or to develop a more equal society. So that's a rather sort of negative answer to the questions I'm afraid.
Yes, on the democratic right, it's interesting that you're at that question, because something very interesting is happening in Chile at the moment, which is that President Piñera is distancing himself very overtly from the Pinochet regime and from his Pinochet past, so to speak. He voted no. He can say that, and that is true. In fact, he appeared in public demonstrations against the Pinochet alternative in the plebiscite. But otherwise, he was a member of the ruling sector. Now he's moving away from that. But very, very badly. He's talking about some people on the right being passive accomplices. Passive accomplices, the expression he uses. which of course has created all sorts of animosity on the part of the right. They're being attacked by the right now. Now, why he's doing that, you see? One explanation is a very mundane one, which is that he wants to be elected president in 2017. He wants to run for president again and so on. But it's more, somewhat more benign and more serious one, which is that he is trying to create a center of gravity for Chilean politics on the center right, taking advantage of the fact that some people, some sectors in the concertación would be open to that kind of the allure, you see. And that's because, essentially, because of the presence of the Communist Party in the Nueva Mayoría, right? For instance, sectors of the Christian Democratic Party feel much more comfortable with somebody like Piñera than somebody like the Yerke, who was the president of the Communist Party. So in a sense, I think he is reviving an old project, the so-called New Right in Chile, which was abandoned at some point because some of the people that led it disappeared, right? But it was like that, you see. But come back to a position in which there is a center movement, party, group, coalition, whatever, you see, which holds power. And then you have a fringe right, the ex-Pinochet, and the fringe left composed of communists and ecologists and whatever. Now, I don't think that that's a viable prospect, you see, a viable project. But I think that's the way in which is this defining what you're talking about in terms of a democratic right. As for populism, the word has so many meanings, you see. I mean, the classical populism, Latin American populism, which is redistribution through fiscal profligacy, is not possible in Chile. I don't think there's any chance of that. What is happening is a devolution of political participation and political power to some extent, you see, from formal structures to informal structures, to movements, from parties to movements, from institutions to grassroots, and that will continue. It's true, as Victor was saying, that most people who are involved in the process are now candidates for parliament, you see. So, I mean, there is still a very heavy weight of the traditional structures in the way the system works. But the fact that the population has been mobilized and now it has achieved at least to change the terms of the political debate, if not the decision-making within the system, I think is something that will continue, will not stop here. On the constitution, how feasible is to change it with the present system? See, there are two views. Right? One say it's very difficult, but it's not impossible to use the mechanism of constitutional reform that appear in the constitution itself. Others, and I tend to favor the second view, feel that that's an illusion, see, a chimera, right? That in fact the constitution was conceived to be immovable and changeable. And to try and do it that way would simply mean to waste time and efforts and political energy in trying to do it. The other option is also very complicated, you see, because it's to call a constituent assembly to start from scratch. Now that has to be outside the constitution. The constitution doesn't allow for that, right? And the proposal that is being put forward, you see, is for people when they vote in the presidential election to mark the vote with the letters AC, Asamblea Constitucional. And they were trying to get the electoral college to actually count those votes and announce the results. They refused to do that because they didn't have a mandate. But there's been now a very important process of mobilization, especially of students, including law students, who are going to be going to the precincts. And they're going to contabilize, they were going to count the votes, the marked votes, and they're going to announce by it. Now that happened in Colombia, but it's a precedent for that. So-called séptima papeleta. There was an additional vote that was changed to call it a constituent assembly. And that won a majority in Colombia, and as a result, there was a constitutional assembly. But at that point, in Colombia, the conditions were very good for that, because the security situation was such that people were looking for some way out, and even the Supreme Court of Colombia declared that was a possibility, a legal possibility. That's not the case in Chile. Chile is more uphill to try and do that. Has the constitution been an excuse? Yes and no. As Alan says, there are things that you cannot, it's quite clear, you see. I mean, in some cases you need a fifth-seventh of the total members of Congress to pass certain laws. I mean, it's simply, nobody else in the world has.
At the same time, it is true, you see, that some of the things that have not happened is not because of the constitution, because there has not been political will to put them forward. And that, again, reflects the contradictions within the coalition, within the concertación, whose initial thrust was to replace the dictatorship with the democracy. And on that, they were all in agreement. They also were in agreement that to begin with, they would be not tampering with the models, the economic model. But now all those two things are for grabs, you see. Because the democracy as we know it is the one that Pinochet left as a legacy, and therefore has to be changed, and the model has to change. And there, of course, the differences appear, and as a result, some of the hesitations are real, and not just the result of the constitutional obstacles.
Thank you. I think with regards to the question on the possibilities of a democratic right in Chile, while there haven't been substantial political reforms, and while there hasn't really been a substantial process of justice for the abuses committed during the dictatorship, at the moment only 262 people have been sentenced for abuses under the dictatorship, of whom I think only 62 are actually in prison, one of whom killed himself the week before last, I think. But clearly there's a long way to go in Chile in that line. And the right in Chile, I think, cannot call itself democratic until it has participated in the reform of the institutions that were left to it by the dictatorship, and until it has accepted justice as a prerequisite for moving forward. There needs to be, I think, a mea culpa, as it were, that is in action as well as in the rhetoric of President Piñera. With regard to the lessons drawn from the defeat of the popular unity, I think that the left doesn't really see this as a moment of being parallels with the election of the popular unity. I've seen people talking about parallels with the election of the Popular Front. I've seen people talking about parallels with the block of democratic cleansing, which was instituted by Carlos Ibáñez in the late 1950s, and which reformed the electoral system and the voting procedures in order to make them more democratic. In other words, he brought in things like the cédula, the ID card, and so on. And so I think the lessons aren't relevant yet. What they're talking about is creating a reform process that would enable a real democracy, and then in the future, in the long term or the medium term, you could build a project like the Popular Unity. But one of the lessons that I think you can see is that, for example, this week there's going to be a forum on the democratization of the military at one of the Santiago universities. And so I think this issue of what the military are doing and what doctrine they have is very present amongst those groups that are seeking reforms. Because there is that question in the corner of the room. The elephant in the room is, what are the military going to do about all this? We know that there haven't been serious changes to military doctrine in Chile. We know, for example, that in the Escuela Militar, the Academy of War, the library is called the Augusto Pinochet Ugarte Library, and it has a huge portrait of Pinochet, and it's made of the collection of books that Pinochet donated. So, I mean, that's just a symbolic thing, but the reality is that there haven't been deep changes in doctrine. I think with regard to the constitution, what we can see is a significant amount of optimism. Whether that's well placed or not, we shall see when the elections happen, as to what kind of majority can be achieved by the new majority coalition. Under Article 127 of the Constitution, the President can call a plebiscite on constitutional reforms, but that has to be okayed by both Houses of Parliament, and I think it's with a three-fifths majority. So, they're hoping that if they can achieve that kind of majority in Parliament at the elections and win in the first round, and the social mobilisation, they can somehow wangle a plebiscite and create by some combination of constitutional and extra-constitutional means, a constituent assembly. Perhaps that's being over-optimistic, But we shall see. Again, as I say, this is a kind of movement where everything seems to be in flux at the moment. And that's why this optimism is there, I think.
Earlier on we saw a graph of poverty reduction and how since the tail end of the dictatorship poverty has gone down quite rapidly, and there's been a lot of spending, huge amounts of government spending with an eye on redistribution, and yet the majority of that poverty reduction was down to economic growth. So I wanted to ask, what do you think the focus should be on? Should it be on equality and getting the Gini coefficients and all that right, or should it be on continued poverty reduction through the engines of economic growth? Because a lot of the times you try to create more equality, you attack a lot of the engines of economic growth, because everyone could be as poor as each other and you could have a fantastic Gini coefficient. So what should the focus be on, do you think?
Probably better if I stand up. I'd like to ask about two specific unconnected points. At a seminar here just a few days ago, the question of the uncertainty surrounding the death of Eduardo Frei came up. And I'd be interested to know if there were continuing suspicions about this, or whether it's something that arose relatively infrequently and recently, because we contrasted it with the comment that has been around the death of Payá in Cuba, which was immediately protested and has continuously been protested ever since. Last week, for example, in front of the Swedish Parliament by his widow. So I'd be interested to hear your views on that. And the second point is regards Mapuche culture. I was in Chile at the time of the Allende victory, and I remember being surprised, shocked, in fact, at the very illiberal attitudes among some members of the Socialist Party towards their culture. And I remember, this isn't an exact quote, but I'm faithfully reproducing the sense of what this particular politician said, you know, the sooner it all dies out and these people learn Spanish, the better. Are attitudes as illiberal as that still found on the left?
Are there any further questions around the corner?
Yeah, I think one of the main outcomes of the transition, political transition, was the establishment of a political system. The political system, not only the institutional, constitutional form, but in the agreement of forces, in the rules of a game. So I think it's clear that this political system is under lots of pressure. Of social movement, of abstentionism, of disagreement, the failure of the drop of the right wing. But what are the conditions to see a regeneration of the political system? Was what was crucial to the neoliberal 20 last year? And what are the conditions for the crash of the crisis of the political system? Because I really think what is today is that the core of the problem is not the constitution, it's the regeneration or crisis of a political system with new or the same actors. And what relation have these actors, these political actors, with the new social actors, not only social movement, but the new working class, the new working factions, the new identities. So.
Very short.
Yeah, short. It's a comment. It's about if the right is going to be ever democracy. Piñera supported when Pinochet was arrested here in London. Piñera supported him. It's on YouTube if you want to see how he was so staunchly supporting Pinochet and against the Spanish judge Garzón, etc. So I really have my doubts of whether one day we're going to have some sort of democratic left. That's coming from Piñera, who is now being praised because of the closure of the, of this prison, the Cordillera prison, and all what's been going on lately. And secondly is, we have been talking about the sort of authoritarian enclaves, yeah? Let's say the constitution, the binominal system, and all these, the economic, the poverty, and all these other indicators. But we have not talked about the moral enclaves. And those moral enclaves, they are not hierarchical. They are the church. I mean, they are somewhere there, talking about women, abortion, because my interest is women. Women from the left or from the right, but rights for women. I mean, abortion is something that is never going to happen if the Catholic Church and the Christian Democratic Party is in that new majority. This morning, someone was saying on radio, I will never accept abortion as an issue in this new majority. I mean, this is Salim, yeah? So how can we integrate other groups like women, for example, women's demands, in this discussion of a very male-orientated approach to the Chilean politics?
Okay, thank you. So.
Well, I wish I could answer these questions. the point about economic growth, I think, that one problem is it's basically commodity-based growth. Right? It's due to copper prices above all. Copper is extraordinarily high proportion. Copper prices fall from some recession, the economy's in a mess. You really have to restructure the economy, the developers, California, medium small enterprises. All the concentration is on the large enterprises, not on the medium small. So there is need for some sort of rethinking of the Chilean economy to make it less commodity. To invest in high-skilled workforce and try to develop a much more diversified economy. It's highly concentrated on a few small, small number of very large sectors, copper, forestry, wine. Without those, and if prices do fall a lot, it's very difficult to feel secure about the economic future. On the death of Frey, rousing suspicion, I'm fairly sure he was killed. But I think he hadn't aroused very much interest because so many others were killed. I mean, he didn't start with them. He succeeded through many, many well-known figures, Bernardo Leighton, Carlos Prats, and so on. So Frey is just one more figure, in a sense, of crimes committed against against leading politicians. On the regeneration of the political system, I wish I could regenerate the British political system. It's a very difficult question. You see, in a sense, because you have had a degree of reduction of poverty and so on, you have a kind of sort of, I won't say contented apathy, but rather sort of discontented apathy towards the political system. Young people don't vote. You know, the 18 to 24 year olds have got an extraordinarily low level of participation. It may actually increase the low level of participation with a change to the voluntary vote system. So, it's difficult. Of course there are protests, but look, that's in a sensitive point way forward on the system, but it's not really threatening in a way the kind of fundaments of the existing system. And they do tend to be rather specifically oriented towards education, in this case of the subcontractistas, towards better employment conditions. So you don't see a kind of overall alliance of all the social and mobilized groups towards some kind of regeneration of the political system. It's very difficult, especially if the economy is doing reasonably well. So you can buy off, you can have lots of social programs. Undoubtedly, people in Chile are better off in terms of health and other indicators. And it's very difficult, I think, then to have a sense that there's a real systematic crisis that needs to regenerate or the constitutional assembly. Position of the assembly in some way to solve all the problems. On the question of women, what do you expect with Opus Dei is in so much control? I mean, it's going to be very, very difficult. The Chile is extraordinarily reactionary in this sense. And what's, in a sense, disappointing is the church, which is so important at the time in defense of human rights under the dictatorship, is now so important in defense of the sorts of policies that make Opus Dei politicians. Yeah, so in a way it's very difficult. There have been some very, very cautious movements in terms of divorce, but I think abortion is an issue. It's very difficult to see any change taking place. But I think this is again, I go back to the percentage point, I think maybe it's the awful electoral system. The electoral system freezes these kinds of alliances. very difficult for any change to take place. Another reason for the regeneration of the system, a move back to a PR system, open or close this, whatever, would be much more likely to encourage people to vote. They have a free choice. What's the point of voting when you know X and Y can be returned? I mean, it doesn't, what surprised me about elections in Chile is how high participation is, not how low it is.
Yes, very quickly on the six I have written down, six questions. On poverty, this is the graph that I did not show. This is extreme poverty. And that was nearly 18%, 17.5% under Pinochet. It's now 2.8%. So it had gone down substantially. You see. I mean, poverty is no longer the issue that it used to be. And therefore, the issue now is relative poverty, is inequality, is in effect the middle class, which is saying we are getting the raw deal. So they will, they will continue with the effort to even reduce it further, you see. But basically, people feel that that area was taken care of somehow, and that what you have to do is make sure that it doesn't deteriorate. On the Eduardo Frey question, there is a court case that is going on, you see, and that's still going on, very slowly, etc., you see, but there are proceedings in court to try to determine whether K was assassinated, was murdered, when he was in the clinic being operated after the operation. Like Alan, I think that there is a lot to that. So far there's been no conclusion, you see, and therefore we don't know. But certainly the family of Frey is very active in trying to keep the case alive. And I say there is a process going on, you see, that, where there are submissions to the courts on that. Now, on the Mapuche thing, you see, this in fact touches on a couple of other questions, because it touches on a very serious contradiction in Chilean politics and society, you see, where the left, the socialists, the left generally, the progressives, so to speak, nevertheless have pockets of conservatism of an extreme kind. Right? In the case of the Mapuche, is the old notion, you see, that the task of the progressive is to integrate the indigenous people into the national identity. Right? That was the progressive thing at the beginning of last century. You see. But still some people feel that way. This is a nuisance, you see. Why don't they just become Chilean citizens and we'll get them everything they want, you see, right? That contradiction is still there, you see. It's not part of the imaginary of the left to think of some of identities, right? They think there's some integration. That applies to women too, you see. I mean, the Chilean left has always been machista. That was the thing, right? And it continues to be. Now, the different story is a question of value. Well, to say the point about the moral bastions, it's true that there is some kind of a revolt within the Christian Democrats now against the possibility of putting these things there. And Saldivar just declared, as he was one of the leaders, that he would not vote for a constitution that legalizes abortion, even if it's given the party instruction to do that. Now, an interesting point, you see, is that the Pope is saying other things. He's not saying that he's in favor of abortion, but he's saying let's not be totally beholden to the issue. There are other issues in the world, and other issues in the church. They should not simply be the one that dominates, right? And let me say that as a result of that, in the Chilean press, there are beginning to appear letters from well-known Catholics who are distancing themselves from the position of the Pope. Now, for a Catholic, that's a very serious take. And the latest one appeared 2 or 3 days ago in Mercurio, and the man cites G.K. Chesterton, who seemingly wrote, "When I enter a church, I take off my hat, but not my head." So he said, I'm gonna listen to what the Pope says, you see, but I beg to differ if need be on certain issues. But it's interesting that the Pope seems to be leading an aggiornamento, a modernization of the church against the wishes of the more conservative ones in Chile. On the political system, yes, the deterioration of the political system in Chile in the eyes of the people is incredible. And if you, all the opinion polls, if you ask the question, do you trust
the parliament. 12% say they trust parliament. 12%. And 88% say they don't trust parliament. You trust the courts, you trust the... But again, the parties, the political parties, right? The trouble is that, again, there is a contradiction there, you see. Because when it comes to the crunch, Chileans go back to the old structures. Be the parties, be the parliament, be the judiciary, be whatever, right? And as I said, it's telling the fact that the leaders of the student revolt are now candidates to being deputies, members of the Chamber of Deputies. Now, they say they're going to do something else. But one of them, two of them, in fact, are communists, so they belong to a party. But others are not. They're creative movements of their own. But the fact that they chose to continue their political fight in that way, becoming, in fact, members of parliament, says something, right? What will happen? I don't know. As Victor said, you see, in the last election, the first time that the vote was voluntary, you see, the abstention was enormous, right? What will happen now? Bando doesn't know. It's not impossible that the participation goes up, not to the levels, of course, before when the vote was compulsory, but that will work. But that will give us some indication as to whether the political system is retrievable or not, right? Or if it's simply its terminal stage. Finally, on Piñera and Pinochet, that's right, yes. I mean, it's very difficult for people who were in favor of the system, you see, to say now whether it's right. Unfortunately, as we both know very well, it wasn't just Piñera that defended Pinochet when he was in prison in London. Minister of Concertación governments. Of course, they were doing their job. It's difficult to ask them to do something else, you see. But one of them resigned, and it's to his credit, Jorge Arrate resigned because he said, I cannot be party to a cabinet that is collectively supporting the case of Pinochet. Others decided to stay on, and as a result, they did appear that they were supporting Pinochet, right? Now, Piñera is trying to separate out those who first of all, were in favor of a change of government after the popular unity, which was, according to them, a total disaster, right? Secondly, thought that the military were going to introduce some order and then return to the democratic channels. And those who still long for the old days of Pinochet, you see, with his protected democracy and with and repression and everything else. And Piñera is trying to mobilize the former, you see, and is making some headway. I mean, it's interesting that the 40 years of the coup in Chile evoked enormous public attention in the media, in debates, in private life, even, right? And it was all in terms of the coup and the repression and the brutality of the coup. I mean, nobody. Not even the proper Pinochet produced any public statement saluting the coup. They would say something here and there, you see, but there was nothing. There were no seminars, there were no demonstrations saying we should celebrate the fact that 40 years ago we were freed from communism. Nobody said that. The terms of political debate moved exactly in the other direction. Everybody who intervened was to talk about the crimes, about the violation of human rights, about the miserization of the people, some to defend that, saying there was no other option, etc. But the agenda was set by those who feel the coup was a major and barbaric interruption of Chilean political history. The others were not able to make the point. And that means that the Pinochet camp, you see, is certainly very, very diminished. Very diminished. The same goes for this transfer of the criminals from it was in effect the five-star hotel into a proper prison, still a military prison, but a prison. Again, when this man committed suicide, you see, the commander-in-chief of the army did not go to the funeral. It was a general of the army who killed himself because he didn't want to be transferred. He thought it must be a humiliation. So he committed suicide. And there was a funeral. And no politician of the right was there, no serious politician of the right, no military figure was there in active service. The daughter of Pinochet turned up, and so on. So
What I'm saying is that Piñera, in effect, is reflecting, you see, a change, a sea change in the whole debate, whereby today, to defend the military regime, what's more, is simply not politically feasible. It's political suicide. And he is a clever man, he discovered that, and now he is, of course, saying that he never defended the military.
I'll quickly talk about the issue of whether to focus on growth or redistribution. I think one of Allende's most important legacies is actually economic. In 1970, his government nationalized the copper industry. And that copper industry still today provides something like 70% of Chile's income as a state. Now, that means that the main driver of all of this economic growth in the period since the end of the dictatorship has actually been copper, with ancillary growth in fruit, forestries and wine. Now, what that means is, if you nationalize copper again fully, that 70% of income is provided by the 40% of the copper industry which is still owned by the state, and through royalties on the rest, right? So the argument is, if you nationalize the rest of the copper industry and the mining industry, then you will have, the state would have a lot more money in which to invest in both the diversification of the economy, in education, necessary for diversification, and also for essentially subsidies to the poor, the construction of a welfare state. Okay. With regard to the issue of the Mapuches and the issue of women's rights and in Chile, I think that these are kind of linked in a way, in that these social movements and groups have narrower visions or more urgent issues that they need dealing with than the political parties, which necessarily have to have policies for everything. And need to try and work out how these policies can be put into practice. Now, this difference in priorities is, I think, the cause of the tensions that exist between the political movement and the social movement. But this is where the idea of what this process, what this election is actually about, comes into play, because for those left-wing organizations in the new majority, this election is not about necessarily achieving all of the goals or creating all the changes that are necessary in Chile. It's essentially about creating the basis for a more democratic system which would in future allow these issues to be debated and brought forward and changed at some point in the future. And that is a difficult balance to make. And there have been significant, I'm not so aware of the women's organizations, but I know that with regard to the Mapuche, there has been a significant effort made to integrate them within the policies of, in other words, they're going to not apply the anti-terrorism law. They will try and give them some forms of autonomy. And going back to the past,
they've been repressed.
Of course they are. I'm not saying that they're not being repressed. What I'm saying is that within the policies, the programs of the Nueva Mayoría, you can see there are some measures that are being proposed. They're not saying that they're going to resolve all the problems of the Mapuche straight away. And in historical terms, I think it's also important to reflect on the issue that in the 1930s, it was the first organization to organize the Mapuche as Mapuche with an indigenous program was the Communist Party. And they were massacred. The Mapuche and the communists that organized that in Ranquil were massacred. Something like 400 odd people were killed by the Alessandri government in that massacre. And since then, it's true, after that there was a lacuna. There was, you know, they kind of abandoned the agrarian issue, as it was then known, to some point in the future. But we should also remember that Allende in the 60s makes the agreement of Ñerol, with the Mapuche, where he promises them autonomy within the Chilean state, their own language, education in their own language, and state-funded Mapuche healthcare and so on, fishing rights, land rights, etc., and gave them back a significant amount of land which had been taken from before, and which was then taken off them again by the dictatorship. So it's not that the left has never had an awareness of Mapuche issues in particular. It's that, yes, you have to admit that some individuals within the left, from urban backgrounds, etc., may well have had prejudices against them. But in the terms of the policies of the left as a whole, I think that you can see there is a concern with these issues. And with Agenda, there's a historic concern with women's issues. Whether or not he achieves any integration, any significant integration of these issues in his programs is debatable. But he certainly has the rhetoric.
Just very simple. I think one important problem with Chile is there's no left wing, there's no centre-right press. It's virtually all controlled by the right. It's like as if the only forms of information have been operated are from the Daily Mail and the Times. But there's one satirical magazine, very funny, called The Clinic, but, you know, it's nothing at all. So how do you get your message across to the people? Because there have been a number of very interesting and very excellent programs about human rights and so on. But there's no way of conveying the need for change, the kind of constant repetition all the day of something that would come from an independent pro-government, pro-constitutional press. It's a terrible, contrasts very strongly with what happened in the Allende period, when you had a vigorous, very vigorous press on for the government. I think it's all controlled by a few small companies, you know, and I think that's a real problem for the for getting its message across to the people.
The conversation closed La Época and all the left-leaning papers by the 94, 96, there was no, the Época was a very center, left newspaper, the same as other newspapers, and they were all closed during the concertación. So how come we can have an alternative view apart from the monopoly or the duopoly we have now, the Unión de Chile?
Okay, I think there's lots more to discuss, and there are drinks served next door, so I hope you'll join us for drinks. And thank you very much again to our three speakers.